Awake, awake, you drowsy sleeper. Awake, awake, it is dawn of day. How can you lie there so long in sleeping, since you have stolen my heart away? Awake, awake, it is dawn of day. How can you lie there so long in sleeping, since you have stolen my heart away? Be gone, be gone, you'll wake my father. My mother, she will you quickly hear. Go tell your tales to some other lover, and whisper softly all in her ear. Awake, awake, it is dawn of day. Go tell your tales to some other lover, and whisper softly all in her ear. I won't be gone, for I have no bother. You are the girl I do much admire. 'Tis I, my dear, who do love you deeply, and thoughts of love that have brought me here. Awake, awake, it is dawn of day. 'Tis I, my dear, who do love you deeply, and thoughts of love that have brought me here. The old man heard the young couple talking, so nimble he stepped out from his bed. He put his head to the bedroom window. Young Johnny, dear, he has turned and fled. Awake, awake, it is dawn of day. He put his head to the bedroom window. Young Johnny, dear, he has turned and fled. So much for love and the valiant hearted. So much for faithful and strong young men. I'll turn my bed on the morrow morning, and call young Johnny return again. Awake, awake, it is dawn of day. I'll turn my bed on the morrow morning, and call young Johnny return again.
Thank you very much. We thought we'd start with a morning song. Good morning. It's a long time since I've sung at 9:30. And fresh after some sugared pineapple was interesting. More than you needed to know. Right, we are the Full English, or we're some of the Full English, let's say. The Full English is a big web portal project which was put together by the English Folk Dance and Song Society. They got just short of £1.5 million or something like that. £500,000 from the Heritage Lottery to put a lot of the most important collections that were made around the turn of the last century, to scan them, digitise them, and put them all freely available online for everybody to access. So this is the website of that organisation, and to celebrate the launch of it, they commissioned us to put together an album of material to bring some of these dusty archive pages, as the press release says, back to life and back into performance. So that's who we are, and we very luckily won a folk award for our album. So this is the context. That's been all fancy in the Albert Hall, and yeah, so today we're talking a bit both about the archive and that process, though we're not archivists, we're not experts in that field, though we've been accessing it as musicians, and talking about the process as musicians of turning things from these paper documents back into contemporary performance. We will do lots of songs, we'll introduce the songs, there'll also be a space at the end for some questions, so if you've got anything you want to say, that's great. If you want to join in, that's lovely too. I don't know if you'll brought instruments or be some choruses.
fancy.
Okay, so there's lots of these pieces of work by this particular group, and it's kind of growing all the time still. As they kind of kept adding collectors to the people who would be included in this archive. So some of the collectors I really knew a fair amount about because I had learned songs from their collection. But my way into the portal was to look more closely at one of the collectors that I knew about. Lucy Broadwood was a very important collector. She was kind of very present right from the beginning of that golden age of folk song collection. And she actually had a family history of folk song collection as well. And she was, her sort of hand in the whatever preservation or putting out there of this material was very, very present. As I say, she edited a lot of other people's work. She collected close to where she lived. She collected in Scotland, and she also collected in the Surrey and Sussex border. I think she did a lot of stuff in. But she also collated other people's collections, and she edited the Folk Song Journal and was secretary of the Folk Song Society. So she's this incredibly active, powerful woman right from the start of that golden age. And I knew her because of a book that I had, that my family had, English County Songs, which I was quite interested in, the sort of geography of it. So that's one of the things about the Full English Collection, is you can search by place as well as name or any other person. Lucy Broadwood, she collected this song, and one of the other things I was really interested in, it was not just using it as a way of learning songs in a kind of pure sense and trying to perform them in a way they would have been performed, but using the music or the words or whatever people had found in the field as a kind of springboard for composition of new stuff. So this song kind of illustrates a little bit of the lack of purity about the way that I've gone about looking at the archive. So it's a set of words that Lucy Broadwood took down in the field, as it were, in Sussex, in Amberley. And it's a quite ubiquitous song. It's called The Servant Man, or The Daughter in the Dungeon. It's quite connected to quite a lot of other songs called things like Locks and Bolts or True Love Denied. It's a kind of forbidden love story. Anyway, so the words came, there they are. Came in this form, this lovely kind of very, I mean, sometimes really reading the handwriting is a massive challenge. So, you know, this one was fun. A lot of them were quite a lot of fun. But it suggested, because there was no tune with it, it suggested a tune. So looking at the rhythm of the words, reading the rhythm of the words as a song, but in this form, suggested this tune to me. So Lucy Broadwood's collected words from Amberley and my tune. It's called The Servant Man. It's of a damsel both fair and handsome. These lines are true as I have been told. On the banks of Shannon, in a lofty mansion, her father chambered great stores of gold. Her hair was black as a raven's feather, her form and features to describe who can. But still this folly belongs to nature, for she fell in love with her servant man.
As these two lovers were fondly talking, her father heard them and near them drew. As these two lovers were together walking, in anger home her father flew. To build a dungeon was his intention, to part true love he contrived a plan. He swore an oath on all his mansion, he'd part his fair one from a servant man. Young Edwin found her habitation, it was secured by an iron door. He vowed in spite of all the nation, he'd gain her freedom or love no more. So at his leisure he toiled with pleasure to gain the freedom of Marianne. And when he had found out his treasure, she cried, my faithful young servant man. Father found that she was vanished, then like a lion he thus did roar. saying, from old Ireland you shall be banished, and with my sword I will spill your gore. Agreed, said Edwin, I freed your daughter, I freed your daughter, do all you can. But forgive your treasure, I die with pleasure, for the one at fault is your servant man. When a father found him so tender-hearted, then down he fell on the dungeon floor, saying such true lovers must ne'er be parted, since love can enter an iron door. So soon they want to be parted never, they roll in riches as couples can. This fair young lady delights in pleasure, contented with her young servant man.
I should have introduced everybody and said why this ties into the conference, because that would be helpful, wouldn't it? We're not just doing a gig. So I'm Faye Heald. I work at the University of Sheffield. We have a strong presence down in Cardiff. It's like Sheffield on sea, isn't it? It's lovely. So I work in the music department there, and I'm also a musician. And over the last year, Nancy and I, this is Nancy Kerr. Woo! We've been involved in a HRC Connected Communities project called Transmitting Musical Heritage, which was looking at various community groups. There's a lot of our projects here this, I want to say weekend, because that's a festival, but you say festivals, isn't it? But this week. So, yes, lots of our other elements are here. This project wasn't officially part of that, but because Nancy and I were working on that as part of the Soundpost Fiddle Weekend, we were doing this full English concurrently, and a lot of the same themes were crossing over. So that project was looking at various senses of heritage and musical heritage and identity and associations with England and nation and place and history and taking things forward. And it hadn't occurred to me that this was also part of that, but hugely, obviously, it is. So that's me and Nancy, and because we were doing that, we've dragged everybody else in. So we also have Rob Harbron, England's finest, well, the world's finest English concertina player. And Ben Nichols on double bass and vocals, he's also a fabulous musician. And so this is us. I'll hand you over to Rob.
Thank you. So the big challenge for a traditional musician really is that obviously traditional music is transmitted by ear. We learn stuff by ear. We learn both repertoire and also style, you know, that all of the stuff you do beyond the tune by ear. And you often don't even realise you've learnt it. You know, traditional players, you know, it's not a form of music where we study technique a lot, but traditional musicians have usually incredible and quite specific technique. So that's a sort of tricky thing for a traditional musician. But with relationship to this archive, it's particularly difficult because they wrote it all down. You know, there wasn't very much recording available in 1908. So you're confronted with a tune that, you know, Cecil Sharp sketched or something. And the tricky thing for the player is to take it off the page whilst sort of remaining true to its essence, but without taking that transcription too literally. So if you see a piece of classical music, it has every bit of phrasing written in, you know, dynamics, articulation, bowing, everything you could possibly, you know, need to know. traditional music's not like that. If you have anything written at all, it's just the dots, just the outline of the melody. So what you have to do is sort of step outside of someone who's used to reading the dots and interpret what's written. So the brilliant thing, have we got the... Yeah, so the next tune we're going to play is a Cotswold Morris tune called William and Nancy. And that's the form, that's collected by Butterworth in Oxfordshire, or the sort of Oxfordshire-Gloucestershire border. And Sharp collected it as well from the same guy. Didn't write it down quite the same. It's actually a lot easier for the player to sort of be freely interpret that writing than if it was printed out, you know, typeset and it looked all formal. So this is what we'll do. This now is our sort of playing of playing around with this little tune. And the next slide as well shows that's Butterworth's sort of setting of it for piano. You know, that's the form he imagined it going in. We haven't quite gone with that, but it's not that's sort of the classical settings of traditional music that Butterworth and Vaughan Williams and the like did. You know, they were pretty close in a lot of ways, so we'll try and let those two worlds meet again.
This one. So, as an academic, the title of The Full English, I had a few concerns. So I don't know if anyone else has walked in with a slight suspicion on their eye. But we inherited it from this project, obviously, and it would seem churlish to change it just and add confusion. There are other elements that have folk song in England or things like that, other ways of phrasing it. But I thought I might just explain what it is a bit, just in defence slightly. So what should we deal with first? The. I'm fine with the. That's all right. We can move on. The Englishness. It's interesting because it is put together by the English Folk Dance and Song Society. They were very concerned with England and preserving an English tradition, but they were also very concerned with regionalism, perhaps more so than a national body, really. The individual collectors were working very locally, so a lot of their collections are in specific areas and places. But it's pulled together in this big way. But the collectors also, as Nancy mentioned, went up to Scotland, did collecting up there. There's some from Ireland, there's some from Wales. We also got quite a small body of collected materials, particularly in here. There is more, but I've heard there's an organisation called TRAC, which is basically the Welsh equivalent of the English Folk Dance and Song Society, and they're keen to do the full Welsh next. So if anyone has any information, do pass it their way. So that can happen. But there is this other material in here. The collectors also went over to the States and collected in North America and in Canada as well, collecting immigrant communities over there and over into Eastern Europe too. There's very little collected of people with roots from elsewhere living in England. It's always trying to get to the roots of English music in this particular collection. So is that enough about Englishness, do we think? So I don't know. We're quite aware to try and represent Englishness in a well, that we're not trying to get back to this kind of purity of Englishness. We as musicians view it very much as a hodgepodge of stuff coming in and are quite happy introducing our own contemporary compositions as well into this. But that's one thing going on. And then the fullness as well. I have a real problem with that, suggesting that this is a complete collection, a bounded thing. And I can see why they're doing that for the funders. You know, you need to make sure you're doing something comprehensive. But it's really not, and that's not the nature of tradition, obviously. So what it is, it started with seven collectors. These are the main collectors in the collection at the moment. So you've got people like Cecil Sharp, who were your key movers and shakers, Ray Vaughan Williams. But then some of the slightly smaller ones, Harry Albino. He's not one of the greater names, but there's about he's got a couple of sketchbooks there, and they're mostly just the really rude, crude songs that you couldn't really do ever. But it's nice that he's in there, so that's good. So there's a lot of other collectors as well that haven't come into their radar, and there was a lot of other material happening at the time that wasn't collected. There's a lot of stuff that happened before this period. This is a real golden age. So this is really a snapshot of that social group of people who pulled together that society. So if you view it in those terms, that's fine, and that's absolutely fine. And what they did was brilliant, and the fact this is here is brilliant, but I'm starting to get more and more problems with now that this is viewed as this is what English tradition is, and that people tend to place anything else in relationship to this, and it's judged on these terms. So our notion of English traditional music is now formed by this, and it's not their fault, we're doing it, but that's still kind of happening. So I don't really have any answers to that, but we're aware of it. And the next song is slightly to address that. So yes, I was quite keen to make sure this went on the album. It's a song, well, it's a poem, a dialect poem, written by William Barnes and set to music by Ray Vaughan Williams. So Vaughan Williams is in the archive, he's in the collection, he collected folk songs, but he set this contemporary written poem to a tune he'd composed himself before he'd really discovered folk music. So this is not folk music, and it's not in the full English, but I just wanted to keep that door open to the prospect that it could expand a bit. So this is Lyndon Lee.
Within the woodland flowery glided by the oak tree's mossy root, the shining grass blades ember shaded does now quiver underfoot, and birds do whistle over. And water's bubbling in its bud, and there for me the apple tree do lean down low in Lyndon Lee, where leaves that lately were a springing do now fade within the painted birds do cease their singing. September top, and round me protest turning red in cloudless sunshine overhead, with fruit for me, the apple tree dooling down low in. Let all the folk make money faster in the Arab dark room town. I do not dread a peevish master, though no man may heed my frown. For I be abroad, or take again this homeward road, to where for me the apple tree do lean down low and
So as well as the huge volume of folk song that was collected by a lot of these collectors, some of them were very interested in traditional dancing, particularly the sort of ceremonial Morris dancing and all the rest of it. So particularly Sharp and Butterworth were really, you know, really inspired by this. George Butterworth, sort of known as a minor composer, you know, was also a fanatical Morris dance hunter. He published a book called Diary of a Morris Dance Hunter, and he was a good dancer. You can tell you this. There's some footage of some early Kinora spools of. Well, first of all, we have Maud Carpley's doing a Bampton Princess Royal solo jig, pretty quickly, and with some funny sort of cuts in the film, and then her and her sister do a double jig, but then you see Butterworth doing a solo jig, and he's a good dancer. And then at the end we have there's the four of them, the two Copley sisters, Sharp and Butterworth, doing a sort of it's actually a dance from Playford. Playford was a collector of dances and tunes much earlier. He published his first collection in 1651, so sort of selling it to the gentry, if you like. So it's interesting to see these more contemporary collectors doing a dance from an earlier collection. Sharp wasn't such a great dancer. He's a bit more of the sort of lumbering buffoon style of dancer. But so what I'll do now is I'll attempt to sort of play to these bits of footage. As I say, they're not you know, sort of clean clean takes. They sort of jump and skip and that, so I'm not going to be in time all the way through, but I'll try and find the sort of sync points. The other thing I wanted to mention is one of the sources of a huge amount of English, of Cotswold Morris dancing, was collected from a guy called Charles Benfield in the sort of Bledington, Idbury, Stow-on-the-Wold area. And I spotted a great quote when I was preparing for this. You know, someone was sort of saying, well, how should the tune for that dance go? And he said something like, well, anyone can tell how the tune should go just by looking at the steps. So there you go, you know, I'll do my best.
Thank you. Hello. So, yeah, so one of the interesting things for me has been, if you look in this archive, there's tunes which you know a version of. And then when you look in the archive, you suddenly find out, oh, actually there's loads of versions of this song, all slightly different. And the next one we're going to do is Rounding the Horn. Now, the most famous version of this, which is the one I originally knew, which was done by A.L. Lloyd and Peter Bellamy, was collected in 1907 by Anne Gilchrist. And that's the version that's in the Penguin Book of English Folk Songs. So it's become the sort of standard version of it. Anyway, I found out that Anne Gilchrist actually collected another version, which was in 1906, which was collected in Anglesey. So I looked through this song and suddenly realised the most common version, the song is about a ship that's sailing out of Plymouth. This Anglesey version is about a ship from Portsmouth. So being a South Coast boy, it suddenly had a bit more resonance. Anyway, I then looked a bit further into it and found out that there's a whole list of different ships and ports, all the same song. You know, they all keep the standard element, which is the kind of Mixolydian tune shape, and the fact that it's about a ship going round the horn, stopping off in Valparaiso to visit the local girls, effectively, which was a fairly standard thing at the time. I think if you were going from the Pacific to the Atlantic, that was the sort of staging post. Anyway, so the list of ships, and these are just ones I found with a quick look, was the Conway, the Amphitrite, the Garibaldi, the Comrade, the California, the Hero, the Convoy, the Cornwall, the Cullen Wood. And ports with Portsmouth, Plymouth, Liverpool, Bristol, Boston Harbour. And so it's interesting because it was collected by different people in different places. Cecil Sharp collected it twice, once on an American warship in 1915, which was the Boston Harbour version. He collected it again in Bridgewater in Somerset. And there's loads of different versions out of Ireland. So, it gives the song quite an interesting history, which if you then look into the nature of the sailors on ships back in the day, I mean, they were from all over the place, literally. I mean, I've been researching the South Seas whaling trade in the kind of 1820s, and those ships would just be, even the ships coming out of England were, they'd have an English crew, but the Nantucket Americans were the best at whaling, so the top five crew, the captain, first mate, and the rest of them would be Americans who were shipped over. The rest of the crew would then have been picked up on their way around the world. So there might be some Maoris in the crew, Americans and Portuguese. So it's not surprising these songs just kind of spread out. People customised them to the ship they were on. The other interesting thing was looking into Anne Gilchrist. She had a bit of an ongoing issue because she collected quite a lot of sailor-related stuff, shanties, songs, and she had this paranoia that the people who were singing the songs were changing the words because she was a lady and they were a little too bawdy to be sung in front of her. So she had this kind of thing, well, that maybe that's not actually how it goes. Anyway, I think the long and the short of it is there's no point being too reverent to the sources you find, because the original singers most definitely weren't. So this is Rounding the Horn.
A ship, she's called the Conway. She's a ship of great renown. She's lying now in Portsmouth, that beautiful town. We received our orders when we were far from home. At first we were bound to Rio and then around Cape Horn. When we got to Rio, we waited there a while to freshen up our rigging and bend our new sails on. with our hearts as light as a feather, we all got underway and steered our course straight for to Valparaiso Bay. All standing in a row with your frocks and trousers as white as the snow. From ship to ship they cheered us as we did sail along and wish us pleasant weather in going round and round. We are around the horn, my beauts, 5 nights and the river we first anchored at was Valparaiso Bay. For to see those Spanish girls and solemnly declare they'd far at the seat English girls with the knobbly heads on. Sailor, fair-hearted and good-mind, for what they have got, they'll share along with thee. They are not the same as you English girls, for they will not impose. And when your money does run out, they will not pawn your clothes. Farewell to Valparaiso, farewell for a while, and to you those Spanish girls, sweetly you smile. When our ship she be paid off, we'll sit right down and sing farewell to Valparaiso and young girls round table.
Thank you. Going back to the idea of this material and the material that it kind of opens up a door to, being a platform for composition. And this is a brand new song that I wrote specially for the Full English Project and inspired by it. And really, the song tries to look at a lot of the dualities about the idea of collection and this particular period, and just the idea of traditional song, really. So you had many meetings. You had collectors meeting singers, and I was really trying to get back to the idea of the stories of the people who sang the songs, not just the people who happened to write them down. But so you would have a collector meeting a singer. That would be a meeting of different worlds. It would be a sort of meeting, certainly of classes. So you'd have wealthy and middle class educated people meeting the rural working class of England, of Britain. So that was that interesting kind of meeting, and also the sense of preserving something, preserving it truthfully or not. And you also had that sense that the Industrial Revolution was really about to change everything, and the war was about to change everything. And so there's a sense of lost rural identity. So this song kind of tries to look at that. I live in the city centre, you know, I don't have a farming kind of sensibility. I don't really have a rural sensibility, except that I do, because I think we all do at some level. And so I think I was looking in this song about how I use traditional song to sort of contact that part of myself, the kind of rural person who is in, you know, a bit in tune with the seasons or is aware of what's happening in the green parts of the British Isles. So this is about Joseph Taylor, and he was a very particularly skilled singer. I mean, going back to what Rob was saying about how the technique in traditional music is sometimes invisible or at least not necessarily formulated. But Joseph Taylor's singing was extraordinary. It was highly decorated. It was pitch perfect. And in fact, he won many song competitions in North Lincolnshire, which is where he was from. Percy Grainger and Vaughan Williams and some other collectors all basically fell very much in love with his voice. So this song talks about Joseph Taylor, his melodies and the imagery in his songs and how I kind of carry that as a city person. So it's called Fol de Deo. Some do sing as though the sun is coming, though the sun is gone beyond the hill. And though blossoms blow and bees are humming, we'll remember cold November's chill. For the day our love is sweet, oh, seeds are blooming underneath our feet, oh, blow the fields through city streets, oh, like a Joseph Taylor melody. Some do leave their gardens wild a-growing, others rule with bed and boundary. For the walls and fences frame our knowing, and the meadows grow our liberty. For the day our love is sweet, our seeds are blooming underneath our feet, oh, blow the fields through city streets, oh, like a Joseph Taylor melody. Like it's the 5th of August and our love is way beyond the fair. For the day our love is sweet, oh, seeds are blooming underneath our feet, oh, blow the fields through city streets, oh, like Joseph Taylor. Upon the wing, there's my garden grown in willow weeping. Now I hear bold Joseph Taylor sing. For the day our love is sweet, our seeds are blooming underneath our feet. Oh, blow the fields through city streets, oh, like a Joseph Taylor melody. Joseph Taylor Man.
Thank you very much. We'd like to open it up a bit now. Partly I'd quite like to show you the archive and how it works and how you can search it. Because I'm very aware, us being musicians, we've got this out of it. But the whole point of the thing was that it would be useful for an awful lot of people in loads of different contexts. They just had a massive schools project in Birmingham with, I think it was 400 schools taking part. And so all these kids had accessed it and learned lots of things. So I don't know if there's social historians or whoever you are, whatever you do, what might you be able to do with the archive? It's interesting. So I might go back to that and show you how you can search it. But also very happy to take questions from you on anything. We don't promise to know the answers, but we shall try. So I don't know. Do you want to fire some questions out while I look at some websites?
I just want to say I thought that was great.
Thank you very much. Have a nice day.
So can I just say how much that seems to be awesome? That's amazing because you've created that out of something that is their goal with archives. That is so amazing. I think I'm going to do that when I go back home. Yeah. I never thought about that. It's just amazing. Really awesome. How long did it take for you to?
It took you about 30 seconds, didn't it?
No!
We had a rehearsal. Martin Simpson and Seth Lakeman and Sam Sweeney are three other members of this group who've worked on all the compositions as well. And Martin, Nancy and I had a rehearsal one day and we looked at loads of Joseph's repertoire. Joseph on first name terms now.
Well, you do. You look at their faces long enough, don't you, and hear their voices. Like, they're old friends.
And Nancy, by the time we'd finished the rehearsal and I'd left Martin's house and got home and Nancy had got home, must have been 10 minutes, and then she sent me this email with the lyrics.
But I'd played this music. In fact, we'd played a song called Brig Fair, which is one of the pieces that Joseph Taylor was most famous for, and it's a very intricate, beautiful piece.
It's also the first recording ever made of English folk songs.
This is it. I mean, this is a written archive, but of course it sparked things that we knew that were out there that were listenable. This is not a listening archive, but there are recordings out there, so this was kind of bringing the truly oral stuff in to the written stuff, yeah. So I find it, I mean, one of the things as a writer that I'm reminded of, and the same thing that Ben said about the pliability of the material and the fact that actually people were not just singing stuff and they weren't just replicating stuff, they were also changing it and they were also composing. So for me, composition sits totally naturally in among this, but it might not at first glance be obvious, you know.
Yeah. So, yeah. It's actually it's a whole other area in there. It's like using traditional material as the starting point for composition. And I did one of these school projects that Faye just mentioned, the school in Bristol. And we got all these year eight kids, you know, playing melodeons and banjos and stuff, taught them a few tunes, and then used the, you know, a lot of folk tunes have the same sort of structure, phrase, answering phrase, first phrase again, sort of variation on the answering phrase, you know, simple structure, but it's a great way of getting, you know, from nothing to a tune in not very long. It's great.
Have you got a phrase of Joseph Taylor's voice that you can hear? Have you got it on your lap?
I've got it on my phone.
So this was actually released as, was it Authentic Peasant Song? Is that what it was described as in 1908 or thereabouts? So he sang it into a big...
A peasant evening. Folk singer.
Peasant, I think, peasant folk singer, yeah, that's right. Yeah. He was a farm bailiff in North Lincolnshire.
Have you got it?
No. We'll take another question while he's finding that. If there is one. Yeah.
For me, it's lovely that you take it back to song, because it feels like if it's just words, it kind of loses something, because it is about that interaction and taking it back into... And because folk song was always so transgressive, I'm kind of thinking about all the border ballads in Northumberland, you know, and the way that they were used to kind of undermine the dominant religion and all of the stuff around women in those. And
the act of singing, the act of performance is quite central to it. And that's why they wanted to do our element of the project and not just put it up there. And I think in various other projects that we do, we're all very keen to bring music back into people's behaviour and that it's not just some consumptive device. So,
I mean, yes, there were people who viewed it as... there were collectors like Child who viewed it really as, like, the ballads as lyrical poetry and not necessarily having that music part. But I actually think the presence of the music is sort of... It's part of that, and it's part of that transgressive other sense as well of it. So, yeah.
This is the album track.
Oh, yeah.
Time.
So this is Joseph. He doesn't have
his
own contemporary band with him.
It's the sound of his voice.
This will have his voice and then us with our orchestration underneath.
It was on the 5th of August, the weather of unfair unto Brick Fair. I did the repair, for love I was inclined. I got up with the lad in the morning, in the heart of the sea, expecting to be the
Can I do a search then? Oh, sorry, George, yeah.
I really loved that track on the album because, you know, you talked right at the beginning about the lack of purity that you sort of took towards the archive and how you, you know, played around with things and sourced them differently. And I love the act of sampling that was in there, and then the way in which there was that, you know, really straightforward juxtaposition of the old with the new there and the crackly sound of it all and so on. But that wasn't my question. My question is, Harry Albino, you talked about him with his rude, crude songs you couldn't really perform, and then you all laugh together because you know what these are, these terrible, terrible songs. And then I was interested in the, you know, the unperformativity of national identity or something like that. And what was it about Harry Albino's songs that are so unperformable?
It's a really silly, well, it's odd. It's the crassness, because I love a murder death ballad. There's no limit to me to the hideousness of songs or the rudeness of songs, but his, they're just, it's that kind of titillating, but just, it's kind of the Ken Dodd, really, of folk song, I suppose. I don't know. I couldn't bring myself to sing that in front of people. And I can imagine contexts where it might be seen as funny, but it's not funny enough to be funny, but it's not. And there's reams of it. It's like, ooh, the ankle, ooh, the knee, ooh, the thigh, ooh, ooh, ooh. But, you know, but it never actually gets there. So it's it's not worth singing. Yeah, I don't know. Can I do a quick little example? Because the problem with us is that we've got all this gear to get out as well before the next session starts. So I'd really like to show you the thing. So if anybody's got a search they want to do, and then we'll try and get out as fast as possible. Is anybody interested in anything in particular? Yes.
Songs about farming. Okay. So in the simple search, you just type in farming, whatever, anything in there. And you get all these, so these are each individual scans. These are this is a Lighthouse farm, and then places, the year it was collected, where it came from, oh sorry, the singer, where it came from, the name of the collector, the Roud number. Now Steve Roud, he's catalogued, he's basically indexed all folk songs, and any song he finds, he gives it a number.
So that's a fascinating system to get into if you're interested in this. So you can find any song with that number and you get 50 different versions of that song. It's a way of sorting it all out. And then you get the scan. And these are the items that you've worked that we work from. And you'll see all these have come up for farming. You can flip through them. And then you go next. Because that's not good. And there are 58,000 scans in here so far. So it's not one you just flick through of a weekend.
It is, actually.
Well, it is, I suppose.
Depends on your weekend plan.
For your advanced search, if you want to go into the field, so if you're looking at a particular place, I'm from Keighley. So just type Keighley in and hope that something comes from Keighley. Yes, we're very cultured in Keighley. So you have these two, it looks like. Yeah, two collections from there.
Accounts of Mummer's Plays.
Accounts of Mummer's Plays, perfect. So you can
do songs, there are documents.
Songs, dances, lessons. Plays, there's diaries as well, so the field notes and things lessons. From the trips to the States are great. In terms of social history and things like that, it's incredible. I don't know, should we do our final song and then go? And then we'll be kind of hovering around if you'd like to ask any more questions. Do, please.
We could talk all day. That's the problem. I will get him up. It says... This this song, as I say, there were 58,000 songs there, and we were commissioned to do a show, do something, with no real other boundary to that. And so I was getting a bit sick of looking through everything and getting lost and trying to work out, well, what should this be? Trying to get categories. And we should be doing new things, but this is all, and I don't know what we're supposed to do. And then I found this song. It's called The Man in the Moon. And the first verse lyrics just kind of summed up my panic of the day. And that the lyrics are as they are there. I haven't written this to represent the experience, but it does so well. And it's part of that kind of music hall culture time. It's collected by Alfred Williams, who is interesting as a collector because he was of the working class, who was self-taught, did a lot of education, taught himself loads of different languages, and got very interested in local culture and history as well, and folklore. A song called The Man in the Moon. Are you up for singing? We'll give you the words. We'll sing along as well. So thank you very much. We hope to see you again.
Is vexing, no doubt, to find when you rise that the wine has run out. Sure, it's an equally unpleasant thing to be asked for a song when you've no left to sing. I could sing something old if an old one would do, but the world, it is craving to have something new. What to select for the words or the tune? I in fact know no more than the man in the moon. The man in the moon, a new light on us arose. He's a man we all talk of, but nobody knows. And though a high subject, I'm getting in tune. I'll just sing a song for the man in the moon. 'Tis said that some people are moonstruck, we find, but the man in the moon must be out of his mind. But it can't be for love, for he's quite on his own. No ladies to meet him by moonlight alone. It can't be ambition, for rivals he's none. At least he is only eclipsed by the sun. But when drinking, I swear, he is seldom surpassed, for he always looks best when he's seen through a glass. The man in the moon, a new light on us arose. He's a man we all talk of, but nobody knows. And though a high subject, I'm getting in tune. I'll just sing a song for the man in the moon. Friends to console him, no children to kiss, no chance of him joining a party like this. But he's used to the high life, all circles agree that none move in such a high circle as he. And though nobles go up in their royal balloon, they're not introduced to the man in the moon. The man in the moon, a new light on his rose. He's a your talk of, and nobody knows. So though a high subject, I'm getting in tune. I'll just sing a song for the man in the moon. The man in the moon, a new light on us arose. He's a man we all talk of, but nobody knows. And though a high subject, I'm getting in tune. I'll just sing a song for the man in the moon.
Avenges the loss at UFC 196. And we are headed out to Vegas now, joined by Gilbert El Nino Melendez, who joins us live here on SportsCenter. Gilbert was in the corner of Nate Diaz of this fight, but also obviously an analyst for us. So I will ask you this question with that as an introduction here, Gilbert. Did the judges get it right?
You know, it was a very close fight. It was a beautiful fight. Both guys showed heart. Warriors, in my opinion, I believe Nathan won the last three rounds, which are the most important. It was very close. It was a matter of one round in this fight. 47-48. Two judges, one judge called it 47-47. Nate's notorious as a slow starter, and he comes on stronger at the end. But it's a very close fight. Could have went either way, in my opinion, but I did have Nate win in the last three.
Certainly, it seemed like McGregor won at the very least the first round, likely the second one as well. So, Gilbert, what did Conor McGregor do well enough in the judges' eyes to win this fight?
You know, Conor McGregor fought a very tactical fight. He didn't push the pace too much. He picked his shots perfectly, and he capitalized and landed some really good ones on Nate. And from there, he kind of ran with it and was able to knock him down a few more times. And that's what kind of gave him that big lead, I believe, on one judge's scorecards. And he also landed the leg kicks as well. And he paced himself really well to last the fight, because I believe he did lose momentum in the fight, but he left enough in the tank to survive and to win the scorecards. And it was a great fight on both guys.
It certainly didn't look like he would have enough left by the end of the third round. He looked gassed, but he found enough in the fourth round, it looked like, to come back in this fight. We will talk about just the second career win by decision for Conor McGregor in just a moment. But this was McGregor. Gilbert, I want you to listen to this following the fight, talking about the possibility of a third showdown with Nate Diaz.
This time at 155 pounds, I came up to 170, faced the bigger man, overcame my adversity. Now you want this trilogy, it's on my terms. Come back down to 155, we'll do it.
I gave him number two the second day, so I'm ready to go again.
All right, so Nate Diaz saying he's willing, no uncertain words, to do it for a third time. Gilbert, of course, you've been in camp with Nate Diaz. You were in his corner tonight. McGregor says he wants the third fight to be at 155. Is Diaz willing to go to 155?
Absolutely. You know, everyone's been talking about McGregor fighting the bigger 170-pounder, but Nate Diaz is a 155-pounder. He is a lightweight. He's number four in the world as a lightweight, so he's going to go back to that weight class. And whoever wins that fight will most likely get a title fight. So, yes, I think this is a great thing. This is actually a great thing for both of them. Even though Nate lost this fight, he's a winner. Why? Because he gets a third fight with Conor McGregor. Two of the biggest stars in UFC, if not the two biggest stars, are going to do it again three times. I'm excited for that. Who doesn't want that?
You know, after the fight, it was a cool moment we saw in the ring. Gilbert, you and Nate put your heads together. You said something to Nate at that point. What can you share with us what you told him?
You know, we just talked. I told him he's a warrior. I told him that was a beautiful performance. You know, for us fight fans that really understand the sport, it was like watching a ballet or a symphony if you really know the tactics that is going on there. These guys are in so much chaos and maintaining composure. And I just told him he's a warrior. I feel like he won that fight, and that was a great show, and he's the man for that. So, you know, that's my brother out there. I was proud of that performance. There's no shame in that at all.
Listen, for you, you said a mouthful right there, Gilbert Melendez. No shame in what either one of those men did tonight. That's Gilbert Melendez joining us from Vegas tonight on the night that Conor McGregor avenges his loss in UFC 196 to come out with a win here in UFC 202 tonight. And we are joined again by our pal Frankie Edgar here. You heard Gilbert mention that Nate would be willing to fight at 155. So they fought, if they fight at 155, if in fact that does happen, the advantage there goes to, I mean, I would think McGregor, right?
Well, I think you would think that just because he's the smaller guy, but like Gil said,
Nate's really a 55-pounder. That's where he's had most success. He's ranked number four there. So I still think it's kind of a toss-up. I think it's, they're going to both have to cut weight. They're both going to have to struggle a little bit. I guess it's going to see who can make the best adjustments for the next one.
As we sort of take a deep breath here after diving right into what was an unbelievable fight, I want to go back to just the overarching theme of this fight, which was two men who, if we believe what we saw in the pre-fight news conferences, who don't like each other very much, giving us 25 minutes of fury. How, as one of the best in the game yourself, how would you describe the heart that we saw from both of these guys tonight?
It was amazing to see. You know, a lot of big fights that come up usually never live up to hype, and this absolutely lived up to hype. These guys are both bloody. They left it all in the cage. You know, we all got to tip our hat to both of them. You know, win or lose, I don't think there's any losers in that one. They're going to probably run it back for a very lucrative third fight, and the fans are going to win again.
The biggest reason that Conor McGregor won this fight tonight was what?
I think he just had the better game plan. He came out smart. He was able to weather the storm in the middle and have enough in the tank to finish it off.
How difficult is it for a knockout puncher like Conor McGregor? I mean, he's got two majority decisions in his career, including tonight. So how difficult is it to adopt that sort of a game plan in a fight of this magnitude?
It's tough, you know, and you could see Conor tagged him early in the first and second. You could see he was really trying to put him away, and usually in the past he would let it all out to put him away, and he did, and if it didn't work out for him like it did last fight, he gassed out and didn't have enough. In this fight, he just kept just enough in the tank so he didn't blow, you know, totally let everything out and have not enough to finish the fight. This time he was much more smarter in that aspect.
We gave so much credit to both guys after the first fight. I think we gave a lot of credit to McGregor for coming up in weight and performing and being willing to take that risk. How about the credit to Nate Diaz for taking some of the punches he took in this fight tonight?
Yeah, Nate's a warrior. Not surprised by his performance one bit. You know, he's been in this game for a long time, and turns out good performance after the next. And he left it all in there. He was a bloody mess, and he was ready to go. You know, he really turned it up, and he faced a lot of adversity. So I'm sure he's looking forward to a third fight.
By the way, what's been left out of the discussion here because of the magnitude of this fight and those two fighters was the knockout punch that Anthony Johnson threw in the undercard.
I'll tell you, that guy's amazing. He might be able to knock out King Kong. That guy has such power in his hands, and that's going to be a good rematch for him in D.C.
Well, Frankie Edgar, great to have you here breaking it down for us on a night that Conor McGregor again goes up in weight to fight Nate Diaz, wins a majority decision victory in Vegas. We will be heading out to Vegas much more throughout the night here on SportsCenter.
Trilogy, it's on my terms. Come back down to 155, we'll do it.
Okay, I gave him number two the second day, so I'm ready to go again.
All right, let's bring in now Gilbert Melendez, who trains with Nate Diaz, was in his corner on Saturday night, joins us from Las Vegas. Gilbert, first of all, let's talk about the result of the fight, because this was an absolute battle between two warriors. Did you agree with the outcome?
You know, both of these fighters did a great job, and they're both winners at the end of the night. No, but I did not agree with that outcome. I do believe Nate Diaz won those last three rounds. That second round was great. And a couple of those moments at the end of those rounds, I felt like he almost had the finish there. And at the end, he landed up on top. And if there were more rounds, I believe it was going to go Diaz's way. But I do understand how the cards went the other way. It was a matter of one round in this fight that could have went the other way. In my opinion, my teammate won by one round. But in others, Conor won by one round. So no shame in this loss for any of those guys. They're both winners in my book.
It looked like about halfway through the fight, maybe into the third, start of the fourth, that Conor McGregor really started to get his second win. Did it look like that from the octagon side?
You know, both of these guys have an energy bar, and it comes and goes, and you got to be careful that you don't waste all of your energy. Once your energy bar is down, your chin goes. So I think Conor McGregor did a great job of working his energy bar down, but letting it recharge up. And Nathan Diaz did it the same thing. So you see these exchanges where he's going for the finish, but just this reality, you have to take a little bit off because you got to have it in the tank for the later rounds. So it was a back and forth fight. It depends what you think, who had the better moments in the later rounds and those extra rounds. And I thought Nathan did with this punch combinations.
Gilbert, rare is the time that fight fans want to see two fighters go at it for a third time, but both fighters seem to want to do it for a third time. Conor wants it at 155. Could you see that happening?
Yeah, absolutely. Everyone's been talking about Nathan Diaz being this huge 170-pounder, but he's a 155-pounder. He always has been. They just fought 170 pounds for that first fight, and now this second. He's ranked number four in the world, not at 170s, at 55s. He's fought for the UFC title at 55s, so he will make 155s, and they'll both fight at that weight class. No problem. Nate is happy with that.
All right, very good. We'll see when they're going to schedule that. It seems like it's a matter of when, not if. Gilbert Melendez with the very latest from Las Vegas. Let's bring in now Frankie Edgar here in studio in Bristol. Breaking news just coming out that Conor McGregor, Frankie, suffered a broken foot during this fight and continued. And pretty clear to see how that could have happened because there was just constant leg kicks to the side of Nate Diaz's right leg. Did you think his game plan was on point?
Yeah, I think when he came out, he did exactly what he needed to do. He needed to be calculated and definitely keep that leg kick distance. And I believe he threw 20 leg kicks and probably broke his foot on one of them. But yeah, I thought he picked his spots well. And like Gil was saying, he didn't let zap his energy too early on.
You never want, you know, fighters to make excuses, and these two guys did not. Now, Nate Diaz did say in his post-fight interview that he had a bad rib, but he never said anything. Conor McGregor should have finished me off. Conor McGregor suffers a broken foot. When you hear those two things, does that take this fight to even higher level than what we watched?
I think it does. You know, if Nate kind of did look maybe a little flat at some points in that fight, and Conor maybe stopped throwing that leg kick because it covers his foot, and you give guys those tools back, and the fight can only be better.
It came out before the fight that this was the highest base pay that the UFC has ever seen. Conor McGregor gets $3 million, Nate Diaz at $2 million, far more than that with the pay-per-view buys. It makes business sense to see this fight a third time. Why would Conor McGregor want to bring it down to 155 for people who may not understand that?
Well, Conor's the 45-pound champion, and, you know, I think he's naturally probably a 55-pounder, along with Nate. You know, they just really didn't cut weight for this fight. They're both probably naturally around 170, 175. They cut minimal weight to get down to the welterweight. At 55, it's probably more natural for them, and I think Conor probably thinks he'll have more advantage down at 55.
Joe Rogan said before this fight that if Conor McGregor can perform like this, that not only he can get back the mystique he had before, but maybe gain some. What did you make of Conor McGregor not only standing there taking the shots, almost looking like he was going to get knocked out, and then come back and win this fight in five?
Yeah, I think he proved a lot to a lot of people, including myself. You know, you've seen his last fight, he kind of packed it in against Nate, got tired and kind of, you know, took a shot because he didn't want to get dropped and kind of, you know,
He gave Nate
the fight. And this fight, you know, he back was against the wall. He got his second win and found a way to make it out with his hand raised.
When you have a fight like this, and for me, this is one of the greatest fights that I've ever had. You've had your wars as well. What can it do for both fighters to be able to walk out of a fight like this and say, you know what, not only are we going to do it a third time, but we're probably the two biggest names still, regardless of who won or lost?
Yeah, it's just a boost of confidence for both guys, you know, knowing that they can put it in there, they put everything they trained for out in that cage. It's only the fans are just going to be screaming for that third fight. It's just more money for them, more eyes on them. It's just good for business all around.
All right, Conor McGregor wins it in a majority decision. Just a great night in Las Vegas. Frankie Edgar, thank you very much. You.